What Once Was Mine, Chapter 42, Gothel. Gothel raged for hours after she fled the Hidden Vale. That girl just didn't understand how much she owed her mother. Nearly two decades of her life had been wasted on a child who wasn't really hers. Of course, in the end, Gothel was more practical than emotional. Once she calmed down, she immediately began plotting her next move. There was no sense returning home yet. All the pieces were still in play, and ironically, because of the stupid real witch, Rapunzel had so far avoided winding up in hands of any one noble. Gothel was under no illusion that anyone would nicely hand her over and continue the auction. No, there would be bloodshed before this was over. And then she heard a chilling bit of news. The wretched girl had gone and let herself be caught by Countess Bathory. Was there any limit to that child's incompetence? Disgraceful. Even worse, Gothel hasn't even seen a single cent of the dowry or auction money that was so rightfully hers. Bathory was irrational and violent, her fortress difficult to breach. There was no way to prize Rapunzel out of the situation. It would take an army. Luckily, that was something Gothel could arrange. Tempers were high. Unemployed armed men were all over this place. Armies were easily assembled in such situations, and she knew just where to start. Despite the endless petty wars and border squabbles across the land, wherever there was a large enough campfire and skin of wine, men forgot their loyalties and sang songs and told stories instead. Sometimes even the lords and counts joined in, especially if that campfire was the Snuggly Duckling pop-up. A little bit of the old tavern returned to life. Gothel entered the cherry circle of revelers from the shadows like a rat. The absolutely enormous bonfire reflected large in her eyes. A thrown-together bar stood at one corner of the clearing, barrels of ale holding up halved log for a tabletop. All the old serving wenches were there, and they tried to keep the spirit of the original place, flirting with customers and handing out flagons with threats. "Excuse me, m'lady," the tiny old man said, suddenly appearing before and blocking Gothel. It was the thug known as Shorty. Even underestimated by the authorities, but always a little into his cups. For enjoyment of the fire and access of the quality refreshment that you're accustomed to at the original Snuggly Duckling, we are asking for a pittance of a donation, and all of which will be put toward a brave new Snuggly Duckling establishment. "You must be joking," Gothel said with a sneer, trying to look over his shoulder. When Shorty continued to bounce up and around and block her view, she finally gave in, throwing a copper piece at him in disgust. "Most appreciated, beautiful lady," Shorty continued with a great dignity. "Tonight the entertainment will be from Henry John Dusseldorf, Jr., son of the Baron Dusseldorf, and Don Handy with the banjo and lute, if I do say so myself. Also, we're having a Tuesday takeover of the grub. Ikram and Ayana from the Sun Countries are preparing a magnificent and vegetarian stew for your enjoyment." Gothel growled and pushed the little man out of her way. Someone else might have thoroughly enjoyed the night. It was almost like old times at the Duckling, albeit with more forced hilarity and a few extra knife fights. The old regulars were in back, keeping to themselves. The unusual presence of the multiple lords there with their men meant the silver flowed freer, and so, therefore, did the ale, and vegetarian stew. They loudly toasted Gothel when she made herself known, but also roundly cursed the straits they were now in. "All of this running around, chasing the girl, and what do we have to show for it?" Duke Kraski complained. "No girl, no hair, no marriage, no magical powers. Can't you keep control of your own daughter?" Viscount Fongle raised his tankard in salute of these words. "You mean Frederick and Ariana's daughter? And my future queen?" "Oh, but haven't you heard?" Gothel asked innocently. "I was overwhelmed. Flynn Rider and his evil compatriots stole her, and delivered her to Countess Bathory, who plans to keep her and avoid the auction entirely." Duke Kraski made a grunt of anger and disgust in the back of his throat. He slugged down the rest of his drink and wiped his red, fleshy lips with the back of his hand. "I hate that woman," Baron Samhat growled. "There's something unnatural about her." "She started prowling our lands for victims," Thongle added reluctantly. "Apparently she used up all the young women in her own country." "I'll never say anything against an independent woman or a nobleman's hobbies," Gothel drawled. "But the fact that she has Rapunzel without paying a cent, You have all been cheated out of your chance, and by a villain. Why, Lord Kraski, don't you say your cousin's daughter was kidnapped by her? From her boarding school, aye. That's what he claims, Kraski said. She disappeared one night, no trace, but Bathory's carriage was supposedly seen near the place earlier. Well, if she's moved on to our noble girls, it's long past time we stopped her, Samhat said, slamming his fist down. Rapunzel is as good an excuse as any, and a better prize than most. Down with Bathory! Men cheered, raising their tankards in the air. Serving wenches looked at each other and shook their heads. How long had girls like them been disappearing and no one cared? Gothel set a small, demure smile across her lips. Let them have Rapunzel, Bathory, whatever. Let them raise their swords and kill each other for glory or gold. This was what she craved, to make men and women do her will. Without coin, a throne, threats, or magic, this was power.